Hello, this is Rabbi David Eidenson, author of the book Secret of the Scale on Marriage and Human Relations. Our website is secretscale.com, and our website on family is thetorahfamily.com. Today, we want to talk about a new and exciting thing, the Anthropic Principle and the ideas, how human beings fit into the universe. And somebody sent me a video that talks about this, a very strange, interesting video. The person who made the video was an atheist. But the atheist discussed about the ideas that the creation, or the, he doesn't call it the creation, he calls it the universe, how beautiful it is, how interesting it is. And he says one thing that everybody agrees on, and that is if you look into the universe and see the millions and billions and trillions, and you can't say the number of the stars and the planets and the all whatever is out there, you can't say the number of it. But it's extremely unlikely, as far as we know today, and we've seen a lot, it's very, very unlikely that there's another place in the universe where a human being could exist. For instance, if the temperature on Earth was a temperature like in other places, either extremely cold or extremely hot, human life could not exist. And to create human life, there has to be other conditions, chemical conditions, there has to be carbon, there has to be this, has to be that. And so for this person who was a scientist said he agrees that the ingredients for creating people or having people or people popping out, whatever way you want to put it, is extremely, extremely rare and difficult to imagine. And therefore, it's unique. But he said, nonetheless, he doesn't want to get involved with religion. He doesn't want to be involved with the idea that the church had, say, 500 years ago, when this argument really began in the world. 500 years ago, the church was angry at Copernicus because the church said that the universe was created for people, which is the biblical idea, that God created the world, that he created it with a purpose. He just didn't create it to float around. He created it with the purpose that there should be human beings. And human beings come into the world, they look at the great universe, and they fear God and they worship God. But Copernicus said, no, people are just things like everything else, and the universe has its own way, regardless of what the biblical teachings may not be. And that, for many centuries, was a scientific view. Putting religion aside, putting God aside, just look at the universe as it is, and people are just part of the package. And what has happened recently is that there's been a change, and the Anthropic Principle, you can go on the internet and check out the Anthropic Principle. The idea of the Anthropic Principle is Anthropic means, Anthro means people. That new scientists, and this goes back a few generations at least, the new generations of scientists are not going the way of Copernicus to put away people. They're saying it's obvious when we look at the physics and the biology in the universe, and we look at all the astronomy and what goes on in the universe, that we, and for other philosophical reasons besides the scientific reasons and the biological or physical reasons, we have to think differently than Copernicus. We have to say that human beings are essential and important, and there's all types of ways of playing with this. But basically, this has come under the idea of the Anthropic Principle, and you can just look up the Anthropic Principle anywhere and see the various arguments and different manifestations of this idea. Let's give people some more importance here. Let's understand the universe was designed for people, and if it wasn't a special act of designing, people wouldn't be here. Especially in the Earth, there's all types of very, very incredible, don't call it coincidences, we call it a fact that there seems to be a design here to create people and put people into the universe. And that's a very important idea, and the interesting thing is this atheist, on the one hand, is discussing about the fact that it's such an incredible universe, and it's such an incredible, impossible feat that there should be human beings in the world. And at the same time, he says, oh, we're just going to die and disappear. And meanwhile, while we're all still alive, we have to look at the fish and the frogs and all the other things in this nice little video. And that's really a very sad thing. Imagine teaching children, you bring children into the world, and there's difficulties in the world, whatever, you tell them, children, you're going to die, there's no purpose, there's no God, there's no religion, it just, you know what they say out there, Darwin and the survival of the fittest, if you can punch someone out and then wipe out his business, so then you're a success in Darwinian terms. It's a very sad world, and this is really making a big problem for atheists, a very big problem for atheists. On the one hand, they may hate religion, maybe for good reasons, because they say religions make all the wars, and there's a lot of wars that came about from religions, a lot of problems, a lot of fanaticism came from religion, a lot of human destruction came from religion. So on the one hand, they want to fight religion. On the other hand, what are they going to tell their children? They're going to tell their children that they're just like fish and frogs. The fact of the matter is that a stone has a much longer life than a human being. So what's so special about a person? It's really putting children down. You're putting people down. See, this is where everything's holding now. I obviously am a deeply religious person, and I grew up in a scientific family. My father, may he rest in peace, was America's leading battery scientist. He won an award, the highest civilian award for the Navy, for doubling the submarine fleet's batteries those days before atomic submarines. He doubled the submarine battery so it could go twice as far, a great invention, and help batteries all over the world because of this invention. I come from a family, my brothers have medical doctorates or PhDs, and they're deeply religious and Talmudic scholars with beards just like me. So, of course, we're interested in this idea, and throughout my life I've sought out discussions with prominent scientists, and I'm very happy with what I believe. There was a time I got a call from a professor in Colombia, and he says, I read your piece on the internet. He says, I see a rabbi, he's dabbling in physics and science. He says, he was a nice Jewish man, he really wanted to be helpful. He said, Rabbi, I'm sure when you went to yeshiva, you didn't study physics. So he said, I'd like to help you. So he says, but I feel, basically he felt that any rabbi who gets involved talking about physics has to be wrong. So, and he didn't want me to be a fool. So I'm saying this on the internet, and it was picked up, my piece was picked up, and a lot of people read it, and it came to his attention. So he wants to help me too. Next time I talk about physics, maybe I'll have a more of an education. I said, that's wonderful, that's kind of you. But I said, what's wrong with what I said? Because this call was basically an idea that I don't know what I'm talking about. So I said, okay, let's see if I know what I'm talking about. I made a statement that according to physics, the way Einstein and others say the world came into being can't be true. Well, that's a very funny statement for a rabbi to say. It takes a lot of chutzpah, right? Chutzpah. Okay, let it be chutzpah. But again, I met with a lot of prominent thinkers and scientists, and if you think I'm wrong, show me that I'm wrong. Here's what I said. I said, what is the theory of creation, what I call creation? I say God created the universe. What do they say? They say Einstein taught, or others who derived from Einstein, whatever. What people believe today is that the universe was once nothing. Doesn't exist. Not one drop. Nothing was there. Not even debts. Nothing was there. Can you imagine that? Nothing was there. Along came, bam, a dot. Where did it come from? And remember, nothing means no space, no time, no ice cream, nothing. Can you imagine that world without ice cream? Incredible. Pop, up comes a dot. Said I, impossible according to physics. Because there's a law of physics that says that matter cannot be created. Can't be destroyed, can't be created. So how can you believe that a dot came from nothing? It's anti-physics. I believe God created the universe, so it doesn't bother me. This question doesn't bother me. But if you say that there was a physics that was anti-physics, then you got problems being physicists. Now I say, what's the next step you say this through your creation? You say this dot expanded. My dear friends, even I, an ignoramus, a rabbi, doesn't know about physics, but even I know that when a star dies and it crunches together and implodes, it forms into a very, very, very heavy ball. And this ball can be a small ball, a mile big, half a mile big, whatever it is, 10 miles big. But the matter of the entire star that was once huge, millions of times bigger than the Earth, it all gets squashed into a small little space. The weight of this little ball is such that it exerts a gravitational pull so strong that even light cannot escape from it. Nothing can escape from it, not even light. And the force of gravity makes it smaller and smaller and smaller. What does physics say? This dot that came about in a non-scientific manner acted in another unscientific manner by expanding and becoming the whole universe. So that's a very strange physics to give us an explanation, which is unphysics, that the creation of the dot is not according to physics. The expansion of the dot is not according to physics. Okay, what's the third thing? Then there was some kind of a plasma, the theory goes. A simple plasma just floating along in the universe, a simple plasma, and all of a sudden it decided to become complex. This blah, 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 blah plasma turned into electrons, which is an incredibly complex thing, spinning around at the speed of light around a proton, a central thing, and the whole universe became this system. Now, that's a pretty good trick, but it just happened. Boop, beep, beep, just happened. Okay. Isn't there an idea that the universe declines in design and order? Order goes down, not up. That's the theory of entropy. Well, there's different ideas about entropy. Blah, blah, blah. My dear friend, everybody knows entropy. Everybody knows that things don't get more complex. They get less complex. If you go outside and you see a car smashed to pieces, you believe it. But if the next day someone will come and tell you that the car all by itself became perfectly fixed, you don't believe it. No one would even say such a stupid lie. But when it comes to the universe, the plasma suddenly turned into electrons and protons and hoop-boop-boop. So that's obviously ridiculous. So this is my attack. But this professor at Columbia, he struggled on the best he could, but he didn't basically satisfy me with any answers to this. And this, then I told him, I said, did you hear about the Anthropic Principle? He said, no. Well, I would suggest you go on the internet and check out the Anthropic Principle. Now, this Anthropic Principle is an incredibly important principle. And for the last 100 years, scientists have been working on this. Putting people into the science of understanding what consciousness is, what life is, what the universe is. It's a very exciting new field. Well, after a few months of this, he was very kind to teach me a lot of things that I did not know. But the basic idea, I didn't retreat from it. I finally, we decided, you know, we're not going to go on forever. So we both thanked each other, and he was very gracious and kind. And I thanked him very much for teaching me all these things. And we left it at that. And I thanked him for teaching me. And he thanked me for showing him about the Anthropic Principle. So this is where science is today. Now, recently, all of this came into the newspapers. You read articles about it now, about a certain Dr. Alexander, a neurosurgeon who had some kind of meningitis, a horrible disease of the brain, so that his brain was basically destroyed by the disease. At the level that his brain was destroyed, there was not enough electricity or function in the brain for him to dream or to think or do anything. There was only a tiny drop at the very, very bottom of the brain where it had nothing to do with thought and dreams and these kind of things. While he was in this state, he began to dream. He dreamed that he was in a new world. Basically, he called it heaven. He was not such a religious person. He was a regular scientist. Maybe he went to church, maybe he didn't, but it was no big deal about religion. And he believed, like every other scientist, that, he studied Darwin and this and that. Heaven was not something on his list. But now he says, no, I was in heaven. He says, I was in heaven. And he describes what the heaven is. He says, this consciousness in this universe called heaven is totally different than the consciousness on Earth. So, again, he put out a book, Dr. Alexander. You can pick it up on the internet, or you can buy his book. He wrote a book now, and it's really going around, this idea. And he says that everybody knows his near-death experiences. I have a friend that his father-in-law, he died on the operating table, and his soul flew out, and he heard all the things doctors were saying. And he told the doctors, later he came back, he told the doctors all the things they were saying. He was under a sedative, he couldn't listen to doctors. And this is called near-death experiences. And there's so many people have had it that even scientists that are atheists or agnostics, they have to accept that there's something going on out there. So what they said is that at a certain level, the brain goes into chaos and has all types of funny powers, but the level of destruction in his brain and this neurosurgeon, he said it could not support dreams. It couldn't do it. So this is what's going on now. Now, one of the interesting things he writes in one of his articles, interesting thing. Again, we're talking about going back 100 years in science. They go back 100 years in science, and everybody saw what Einstein put out. Everybody's, ooh, Einstein, wonderful things. But that's not the real story. The genius, the greatest genius in the world was Einstein, yes. But what happened exact at that time, there were other scientific people going in a new direction. Their direction was to turn physics upside down. And the ideas that they have are so strange and so weird that one of the major physicists in this field, the quantum mechanics, said that if you understand it, don't get dizzy, you don't understand it. It's just weird. One of the ideas is that if there's a subatomic particle and it's floating around doing its thing, whatever it's doing, and you think about it, you change it. Isn't that weird? If I look at a bird, it's going to change. That's, in this world, it doesn't happen. But the subatomic world, it does happen. And now they're working now on ideas. There was a Nobel Prize now. What was the Nobel Prize? That the ideas that we have in this world about limitations, finite limitations, you can't be in two places at one time, that this is wrong. That in subatomic particles, you can be in a lot of places. So we see that there's a change in the universe, of science. They're looking now past the finite world into the infinite world, where you could be in two places at one time, where your thought goes into an actual object, a totally new type of thought, totally new type of possibilities, where the finite is meaning the infinite. And we believe this is the process that God designed to prepare people for the Messianic era, when people will go beyond the finite and accept that there is an infinite. And in the Anthropic Principle, it will be accepted for what it is, the scientific realization that there is a God and there is a Creator, and He created us for a purpose. This is Rabbi David Idenson, author of the book Secret of the Scale of Marriage and Human Relations. Our website is Secret Scale.